Good evening, everyone. It is 6:01. We're so happy to have you here. We've got quite a few people joining us, and we're going to give folks a little bit of time to get it joining. We're expecting quite a large crowd, and we're excited to start a great evening with you. We'll get started here in a couple minutes, but welcome to AP Night 2023 at EVHS. We have a great night in store for you. A lot of your questions are going to get answered, and all those details will be shared on our presentation tonight. So we'll get started here in a few minutes. Welcome, welcome. Do us a favor, we are going to wait for Q&A. So we're going to wait for Q&A till the end. So if you can wait till we get started before we start asking questions, we'll get started here and we'll tell you the scenario. So do us a favor, we are not going to be answering any questions until we get things started. So give us some time to get things started and we will make sure your questions are answered. So we're trying to make this as real as possible. So if this was a real thing, you'd be welcome coming in, joining us, having a seat. We'll answer those questions at the appropriate time throughout the evening. So welcome again. We're so happy to have you here. AP Night 2023. Mr. Pham, it's good to see you. Thanks for joining us. Are you going to present for both English courses?
Yeah.
Awesome.
So that should be
I'll introduce you when the time is right.
Sounds great.
It's going to be a little bit. So counselors are going to go first, and then Mr. Jaimes is going to do a presentation. Then we'll jump into the portion with the where teachers are going to speak.
I'm going to send
thanks for being here. We appreciate it.
Okay. I'm going to send you a direct message. Yeah. You could respond.
Perfect. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for your patience. We have lots of people joining, and we want to give folks some time to get to join us. So we will get started here in about a minute. We are at 352. We expect several more. So we want to give folks some time to register, and then we'll get started. Thank you for your patience. We'll get started here pretty quickly. But we're excited for a great night with all of you. Thank you. Okay, counseling team and Mr. Jaimez, are we ready to get started?
Ready.
Great, I'm gonna start recording us. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to EVHS AP Night 2023. We are so happy you are here joining us. Thank you for your patience as we get things started. This is a webinar. So if you've not joined a webinar, this is a webinar session. So panelists are on screen. The rest of you will not be on screen. What the way our format works here is we are going to use the Q&A, but we want to make this as live as normal. And so we want you to make sure that you're taking in the presentation. We will not be answering questions until certain times throughout the presentation. So do us a favor and make sure you're paying attention to the presentation. And then we will get things moving and you can join us and you'll have an appropriate time to ask questions as needed. So we are gonna share a lot of information for you this evening, a lot of AP information that will be important for you to know about deciding for your classes for next school year. Mr. Jaimez, one of our mental health and wellness social workers here, and is gonna talk about just maintaining some wellness. It's AP courses are rigorous, so it's going to be important that you make sure that that's the right course load for you. AP courses are quite difficult, and the AP exam can be quite stressful. We want to make sure our students have an appropriate balance with everything that they're doing. And again, here's how it's going to work. We're going to make sure if you have a question, we want to answer your question, but we're going to ask you to wait until the counselors and our social worker have a chance to make a presentation. So they're going to give us a general presentation. Then we'll give you some time to ask questions via the Q&A. We don't use the chat, so we're going to ask you to ask questions via the Q&A. We also are going to ask you to make sure that we keep things appropriate. So last year in this session, we had a hard time with people asking it started to get a little bit inappropriate. So our ask is that it stays appropriate. If it's not, then we will have to stop the Q&A portion and you will not have an answer chance to ask questions. So we just ask that you please be ROAR appropriate as always and ask those questions, but make sure it's appropriate in this session. This is some valuable information that we want to make sure you have and want to make sure you're following along. It is being recorded, so it will be posted. So don't feel like you have to keep up with everything. You'll have a chance to review it. It will be posted on our website probably as early as tomorrow. So the slides and the recording will be available for you tomorrow. But we have a great evening in store for you, a lot of important information for you to learn about and hear about. And so please make sure you're following along and then making sure then you're asking that Q&A when we ask you to open up the Q&A. So we will not be answering in the Q&A until a designated time, which you'll be aware of. So thank you everyone for joining us. I don't think I introduced myself. My name is Shelby Edwards. I'm proud to be an associate principal here at Evergreen Valley High School. We have an amazing counseling team that's gonna get us started off, and then a fantastic social worker that's gonna share some great information, and then several teachers that will have information specific to our courses. So I'm gonna hand it over to Mr. Roberts, our head counselor, who will get things going for us. Welcome everyone.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you again for joining us. We will, as Ms. Edwards said, have a lot of valuable information for you tonight. So we do ask that you listen carefully so that you can get the most out of the presentation. So tonight, your student and you as a family will be making some very important academic decisions. And we want you to discuss this information and really make an educated choice as to what APs you're going to take and how many you're going to take, and to really understand the time and commitment that is involved in an AP class. So again, please consider all aspects of what the student is doing, including extracurricular activities. There's only so many hours in a day, and no matter how much we try to add to do more than we can, we need to consider the student's sleep, social time, and a lot more of this is going to be talked about, but I really want everybody to be thinking about all the commitments, not just focusing in on AP. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so why should a student take an AP? One, it will demonstrate that they are academically mature. And it also shows a readiness for college because AP are college level classes taught at the high school. Okay. They also show a willingness to take very rigorous classes, probably our most rigorous classes on our campus. It gives students a chance to kind of see what college courses are going to be like. They could also use it to look at if they have a career interest and they sign up for an AP course in that area, they may find out, wow, this is really great and I do want to pursue it. Or just as likely, they may say, wow, this isn't what I thought it was going to be, and maybe this isn't what I want to major in. And there is, depending on the college, students may earn college credit by getting a certain score on the AP exam. So you also gain skills for college success. There are many benefits to the AP classes. They will sharpen students' problem-solving abilities. They will learn how to write clearly and persuasively. Again, it's a college-level class, so they are going to be expected to write at the college level. Definitely developing study habits needed for success in once they get to university, to college. It was a big step up for students to go from middle school to high school, and it is a big step up going from high school into college. So this is kind of a stepping stone so students can see what it's going to be like. Practicing time management, again, going back to the fact that there's only so many hours in a day. So students really need to look at using their time wisely. They're going to learn how to think critically and argue effectively. And in the classes, there might be some intense discussions and also learning how to solve problems collaboratively, which is one of the soft skills that companies are always looking for, is for students to know how to solve problems and how to work in team, work as a group. Okay. And so why should you or your child try an AP? Maybe you'll find out that, no, this isn't something we want to do, and that's okay. But if a student wants to grow both academically and intellectually, it might be a reason they're taking it. We have absolutely no entrance tests. We have open AP coursework. So anybody who wants to take it can. And the mission of the AP is to offer any student who desires it as an opportunity to participate in the program. Okay. And moving on, I will introduce one of our other counselors, Ms. Castillo.
Thank you, Mr. Roberts. So with AP courses, at the end of the year, the course concludes with the AP exam, and they are held in May. It is strongly encouraged for students to take the exam. They are not required to earn a grade in the course. The grade for the course and the grade for the exam are two separate items. If a student is taking an AP course, colleges do like to see that students are following through with completing the AP exam in May, so it is strongly encouraged, but again, it is not required. AP exam scores are not listed on the high school transcript. Students will report those exam scores on college applications on their own. So again, the AP exam scores are not placed on the high school transcripts. Okay. AP exams and scores do not determine college acceptance. They can be used for placement when a student enters college. So if a student earns a score of a 3, 4, or 5, so an AP exam score is based off of a 5-point scale. If they earn that 3, 4, or 5, they could earn credit towards a college class. So the credit for the college class is college dependent. So some colleges may accept them, some may not. So that it's going to depend on the college that your student attends. The fees for the AP exams are around $88 each. There is financial aid available for students, and that would bring down the cost pretty significantly to $5 per AP exam. So not only, is the student committing to taking the course, but also, you know, paying for the exam. So at this point in time, if your student is going to be taking their AP exam in May, they should have already paid for the exam in the fall semester. This year, for May 2023 testing session, all testing will be in person. So again, all testing will be in person. There will not be any online exams that they will be taking at home. It's all going to be in person. If things change with the College Board, we'll be sure to, you know, let everybody know of the changes for AP exam testing. So supporting your student in determining how many AP courses that they're going to be taking. You want to make sure that your student is selecting courses that is a really good fit for your student. If they're really strong in math and science, maybe taking a look at the AP math courses or AP science courses. You don't want to start overloading your student with AP courses. You don't want to go from having, the regular courses and then next year taking a full load of like 4 to 5 AP courses. Keeping in mind that because AP classes are college level coursework, a typical college student schedule is about 4 classes within, a semester's time. So if a student is taking, 5 to 6 AP courses for the entire year, that can be a bit of an overload, depending on what they have going on outside of the high school. It is a year-long commitment, so that's also something to keep in mind when you're selecting AP courses. And then kind of going back to making sure that it is a good fit for your student, I know 9th and 10th graders can be eager to start taking AP courses right away because an option is available to them, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they're ready to take that college-level coursework. So be really mindful and intentional when you're looking at the AP classes that are available to your student and just making sure that it is the best fit for them to take. And the number of AP, there is no magic number of AP courses that is required for colleges. There will be nowhere in the college admissions requirement that says your student needs to take X amount of AP courses in order to be considered for admission. It is all student dependent and what your student can handle. So, really stay clear of trying to compare, maybe an older sibling's course schedule or maybe a peer's schedule, because maybe what they took and they ended up getting into UC Berkeley does not mean that that's going to be the best fit for your student. So, we really want to stress being mindful and intentional when you are selecting AP courses for the year. Okay, and I will be passing it over to Ms. Huitron.
Hello, everybody. So I will be going over a typical sophomore schedule. So for the most part, our sophomores will be enrolled in 5 classes that are core classes that meet the graduation requirements and will also satisfy the A through G requirements. So we see a list of history, English, math, science, world language, and PE2. So right now, if your student is a freshman, they should be in PE1 and will be taking PE2 next year. The AP classes that are available to our sophomores, we have some in history, which would be your AP World History, AP Human Geo, and students have the option to choose between the regular World History and the 2 AP courses. In science, we have AP Physics 1. Please keep in mind, in order to take AP Physics 1, students need to be currently in Math 3 or a higher level of math. In this grade, students typically have one more elective section. For those students who are in band, orchestra, choir, leadership, or in the computer science pathway, they have the option to take 7 classes because they'll take their world history, their English, their math, science, the world language, which we highly recommend students to take that second year of their world language, PE2, which covers 6 periods. So if the student decides to take that or wants to take, like for example, 4 years of band, their 7th class would be band. For those students who are in the computer science pathway, they have the option to take the database SQL class. It is optional. So if the student decides just to take 6 classes, they can. If not, they can just choose that the SQL as their 7th class. If your student is interested in taking an AP course, you will be able to fill out your form for the AP forms, which we'll cover later on. Now I'll go over the junior schedule. So for juniors, again, it's 6 classes. The AP courses that are that juniors can take within their junior classes is AP US History, AP Literature, which will cover the English credit. The math level. So for example, if a student junior year decides to take an AP calculus or an AP stats, that would be an AP option. In science, they have the option to take an AP course. And in this scenario, if the student decides to take an AP Bio or AP Chem, there are two sections or two periods for that science course, and they're elective. The example of a student who may decide to take a 7-period day in junior year would be, for example, if the student is in leadership and they decide to take AP Bio and they're elective, they want to take their third year of a world language or a visual and performing arts, that would be considered their 7th course. And during junior year, there are some students that may decide to recover credit, and we can work with our students to be able to take a 7th period. And now I'm going to pass it on to Ms. Nguyen.
Thank you, Ms. Weitron. So the typical senior year schedule looks something like the following. Class number one, all seniors must take one semester of economics and one semester of government, and both can either be AP or regular. This is a grad requirement for all seniors. Class number two, English, which is also a graduation requirement. So either ERWC or AP Lang. Class number three, math. So depending on what the student completes by the end of the school year, it could be going from math three to math analysis or math analysis to AP calculus. Now, class number four, we generally recommend a 4th year of science, especially for students who are interested in any STEM field. So depending on what the student has completed, it can be AP Physics 1, AP Physics 2, or even a non-AP science class. So for example, forensic science or physiology are great options. Now for seniors thinking about class number five, and class number six, we strongly, strongly encourage our seniors to take, at this point, any A through G college prep class, especially if you have not completed your fine arts requirement, because at this point, there is generally room in your schedule to do so come senior year. Now, if you know the student has already completed their fine arts requirement, other good options to look into can be taking another traditional AP class, such as AP Psychology or AP Human Geo. So yes, taking the AP classes is good and helps prepare our students for college. But you know, when you're really thinking about the UC, CSUs, or private colleges, you know, taking 12 or 13 AP classes generally, you know, does not make an applicant stand out, because essentially everyone who is applying, you know, especially to the competitive schools, are probably doing the same. So if you want your class number five or class number six to be an AP class, I think what would make your college application stand out is taking that 4th year of a world language. So AP Spanish Lang, or taking AP Spanish Lit, AP French, or even Viet 4, even though, you know, Viet 4 is not considered an AP class because College Board does not offer it, but the university recognized Viet 4 as advanced. Because if you think about it, taking the 4th level of world language shows passion, commitment, and because really only a handful of students complete this path. So, you know, for students completing the 4-year world language, they can essentially write about this experience in their personal statement and how, you know, challenging themselves with completing the world language sequence is ultimately preparing them for university rigor. And this makes them stand out when it comes to the college application. I also want to talk and think a little bit about, think outside the AP box a little bit. So for class number five and class number six, it doesn't even have to be an AP class. So for example, you know, our seniors can be taking music appreciation, ethnic studies, creative writing, journalism, P PE Fitness. These are all great non-AP classes to really consider. Non-AP classes help our seniors who at that point are worried about college application, personal statement. This allows them to decompress and yet still be learning the necessary life skills that will help them be successful in college. You know, learning about assertive communication, collaboration, stress management, problem solving. These are all important life skills and traits that admission officers are looking for and can be learned through enrolling in non-AP classes as well. So resilience and grit is just as important as GPA when it comes to the admission process. And then one more thing I want to really emphasize is all university, they utilize a process called comprehensive review, right? So this is where admissions, they're looking at multiple factors that goes above and beyond the grades to look at applicants. And so, you know, academic achievement, it helps them look at the student's overall academic potential and how they can really give back to the college life. And so it could be AP classes and also non-AP classes. Now, if current juniors have accumulated a total of 180 credits by June 1st of this school year, they have the option of being on a 5-period day. So this open period gives our seniors the opportunity to get a job, an internship, volunteer, take a community college class, and maintain rigor in that sense. And remember, colleges are seeking rigor both inside and outside of the classroom. So be mindful of this when you're opting for a 5-period day. You know, make it productive. Now, the AP expectations, you're joining us tonight to learn more about AP classes. So after tonight, you're going to look at the course AP form, which will be emailed to you shortly. And then if you have any lingering questions, you can reach out to our AP teachers for course-specific questions. We want you to do all your research before signing up for a particular AP class. And then make sure that your email that you use to log into the Zoom session is correct, because that's where the form will be emailed to. With the exception of Gov, AP Gov, and AP Macroeconomics, all AP classes require a 1-year commitment. So make sure you choose wisely. And then submitting the AP form does not, unfortunately, guarantee placement, because for various reasons, and one of which is with such a large comprehensive high school, we make every attempt to, you know, distribute the AP classes equally as possible. And so we thank you for your understanding in advance. So with that being said, I'm gonna go ahead and page Dr. Soloff to go ahead and walk you through the one-on-one scheduling process. Dr. Soloff.
Okay, so all of your current juniors have received an email from their counselor to their school Gmail account in order for them to go in and schedule a Calendly appointment with their counselor. We go one grade level at a time. So juniors first, our goal is to have met with all the juniors by February break. And then after break, when we get back at the end of February, we will reach out to the sophomore class. And so they should check their email maybe right before February break or right when we get back to schedule their meetings. So check with your student. If you're a parent of a junior, or if you're a junior this evening joining us, please make sure you check your email, because we want to get all those appointments ready to go next week and the following week. At that meeting time, your counselor will have the conversation about what classes you are requesting for next year. We will ask you if you're planning to take any AP courses. You have to bring the form to us signed by you and your parent with it all completely filled out. And if a student is behind on credit and they need to enroll in summer school, we can do that at that time and talk about anything else that's coming up for the next few months, pretty much into summer. After that point, and I should say, as of tomorrow morning, Infinite Campus will be open for students to log in to choose their courses. When they come to the one-on-one meeting, if they've already chosen their courses in Infinite Campus, we'll sit down and check everything against their transcript to make sure they have all of their graduation and college requirements ready to go. If there's a mistake, we'll help fix it. We'll double check everything. If a student chooses an AP class, on ICE Infinite Campus but doesn't bring the form, we're going to remove it. We have to have the form in order to request the AP course. And we're happy to have those conversations as well. If a student has any questions between now and when they have their meeting, they're welcome to email or stop by anytime. And, you know, we're happy to answer those questions. After that one-on-one meeting, the Infinite Campus will be locked. So a student is still able to make changes to their requests. So we recognize the fact that this is a little early. We're requesting the 23-24 school year in the first, you know, very early in February. So and between now and early May, or between, not now, between when the student finishes their one-on-one appointment and early May, if the student makes any changes to what they want to request, there'll be a Google form that's sent out and they can do that. So they can say, I no longer want to take this class, or I've changed my mind, I want to take AP Lang instead of this English class, or whatever it is. They can make those changes up until early May, and then they're pretty much locked in. And we don't really change much after that, except for potentially summer school based on math classes. And I'll talk about that as well. Now, reminder, at this point, these are requests only. And like Ms. Nguyen said, although we make every effort to place students in the classes that they want, these are requests only. There is never a guarantee that this, what a student requests is going to 100% be their schedule. Next year seniors will have top priority, as they should, and then juniors, and then sophomores, and then freshmen. So there are some times when a student requests a class and we're not able to seat them because we only have a certain number of courses or teachers or seats per class, and we're not allowed to overload. And if the student is a sophomore and they don't get their first level class, choice class, then most likely they'll get a junior year or definitely senior year. The confirmation of the actual schedule will happen the week before school starts at the end of July. And they'll have access to that online by checking their Infinite Campus, just like they did this year. So between now and August, there's no schedules yet. So again, requests only at this point. The actual schedule, which shows start time and periods and teachers, that won't happen until the week before school begins. A reminder again, all of our classes are year long, except for GovEconomics. And so the student needs to stay in that class for the entire school year. I don't believe Ms. Nguyen said, and I'm sorry if she did and I missed it, incoming seniors choosing GovEconomics, they can choose AP Gov regular econ, or AP econ and regular Gov, or AP both or regular both. So those can be swapped. But other than those two classes, all of our courses, AP and regular, are year-long classes, which means we can't make any changes. And we can't make changes if a student comes in and says, well, I know there's two teachers for this course and I have this one and I want the other one, or I want to be in that period because my friends are in that period, or the class is hard. Of course the class is hard. It's a college level course. So that's why we're having this conversation now. Assume it's going to be hard. If your student's never taken an AP class before and you're not very familiar with it, assume it'll be twice as hard as the current class they're taking. So if they're enrolled in English 2, AP English is going to be probably twice as much work. And so if your student is able to, you know, they think they can handle that, great, but please assume higher difficulty level than what your student is currently doing this year. Okay, so hopefully some of these questions will answer, some of these FAQs will answer the questions that you have before you even have the opportunity to type them into the Q&A. All of the classes that we request at this point are based on students' current classes and their grades that they're receiving and classes that they've previously have finished. So for example, with math, if your student is currently taking Math 3, then we will schedule them for next year for math analysis. If your student chooses to take math analysis over the summer and they finish the class and they pass it, when they come back, they're welcome to take calculus. But at the moment, in that example, we can only schedule the student for the following year's course. So at this point, we're not going to assume your student's taking summer school. We don't know for sure. Maybe you'll decide to go on a family vacation and your student won't be able to take the class. So for now, we only schedule students based for next year, based on what they're currently enrolled in and passing and what they've previously passed. Our AP classes, most of the time, will fill by the time we're done meeting with all of our students in the first round. So by the end of March, we will be done meeting with all three grade levels. And most of our AP classes will be filled at that time. So if a student chooses to go to summer school for math, it's a 100% definite that we can move them on to the next math level. And there's lots of reasons for that, which I don't want to bore you with this evening, but it's guaranteed. So there's never a situation where if your student took math analysis over the summer and they come back and they want to go to calculus, there's never a situation where they wouldn't be able to do that. Or if they take calculus over the summer, calculus AB, and they want to come back and either do calculus BC or stats, they will 100% get one of those classes. We can't necessarily guarantee which one, but 100% they will be enrolled in the next level of math. However, we can't do that with science. Science is very strict, and we are not able to make science changes based on what a student takes over the summer, either in science or in math. So that one, and all the other courses, we're going to say that if they're 100% based on what the student is currently enrolled in and what they're passing right now. Students are allowed to enroll in one science class per year. This is one of our most commonly asked questions. Evergreen only has enough teachers and lab space for one science class per person. 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th grade. That's a requirement. They cannot take more than that. We've recently done quite a bit of work updating our course catalog. So this is a great place for you to start if you're maybe the parent of a freshman and you're thinking 2 or 3 years down the line. We probably have a whole bunch of electives that you don't even know about. So we recommend that you visit our website, both the homepage and the counseling website. There's links for the course catalog, and you'll see course descriptions, you'll see recommended prerequisites, and there's a whole bunch of information, and they're categorized by subject. So please feel free to look through that, because we offer some cool classes that you might not know. AP Bio and AP Chemistry are both 2 periods, and even though we're on block this year, they're still 2 periods, and they will be 2 periods next year. It's considered one class. Students earn, but they're great. They have two. They get a grade for each because they're a separate period, but it's the same grade, and colleges really just look at it as one course. But technically they get 2 grades because it's 2 periods. They're always the same. So there's a regular period for the course and there's a lab period. And both grades are factored into the GPA. These are the only 2 courses in the school that have a double period, AP Bio and AP Chem. And those are junior, senior level courses. The science pathway is slightly confusing, and it's pretty much the only subject that students kind of need to think ahead, because depending on what course they take sophomore year might help determine what their options are for junior and senior year. So we all know that freshman year is biology for everyone. Sophomore year is the physical science. So students can choose physics, chemistry, or AP Physics 1 if they're currently enrolled in Math 3 or higher. Students don't need to do chemistry and physics to graduate. They need to do one of those in order to earn their physical science requirement, but it's recommended. And especially when in high school, a lot of times students don't know what they want to pursue in college. So it's always a good idea to have a general background in science. And that would be 1 bio, 1 chemistry, and 1 physics. But if you look at the last bullet point, please note that chemistry is the prerequisite or recommended prerequisite for all of those courses. So if your student is thinking ahead and planning for junior, senior year, they're welcome to do physics sophomore year and chemistry junior year, but they need the chemistry for those items. So if a student chooses physics or AP Physics in junior year, they're welcome to continue to AP Physics 2 or AP Physics C. If they choose regular physics in sophomore year, they're welcome to continue to AP Physics 2 or C in junior year, but it limits their opportunities after that. Because chem is really required for any of those classes. And I'm sure the science presentation this evening will discuss that as well. So just something to think about as far as the science pathway is concerned. Okay, little just plug for our website here. When you go onto the homepage and switch over to the counseling website, this is kind of the main page that you'll see. There'll be all the tabs on the right-hand side. One of them has the course catalog that I was mentioning. And there's also, we didn't highlight it, but 1, 2, 3, 4 items above the course catalog, it says AP class information. And that is a much more detailed explanation about all the courses we offer. There's videos, there's details, there's teacher information. And so lots of great stuff on this website that you can check out, as well as the course catalog that has all the subject area. Okay, so I'm going to pass over now to Mr. Jaimez, one of our two fabulous social workers on campus and from our Mental Health and Wellness Center. And we're going to talk a little bit about making sure our mental health is for our students is all good and positive, and looking forward to, thank you, looking forward to seeing you, and thank you for joining us.
Hi, good evening, everyone. My name is Salvador Jaimez. I am one of the social workers here at Evergreen Valley High School. Thank you all for being here today. We've heard a lot of information about how rigorous these AP classes can be. These courses can be very taxing on our students, and we just want to talk a little bit about how we can maintain wellness overall for our students to make sure that they are staying healthy, both physically and mentally. So let's be realistic, right? It takes a little more than just GPA to get accepted into college. Colleges want to consider a very well-rounded student. What else do they have to offer aside from excelling in their academics, right? So they want to look at honors, extracurricular activities. Have they done any community service work? Do the students have any work experience, or have they taken any other classes that builds upon those certain life skills that we touched upon earlier? Also, what we want to do is consider other colleges that are available to our students. I know that we have our goals set on certain ones, but there are a lot of great UCs, CSUs, community colleges, private universities. We really want to start sort of collaborating with our students and kind of having those open discussions in terms of like what is out there besides just those regular pathways that we always consider and talk about. Let's think holistically. So let's not just focus on our grades. Let's try to think about the abilities that our students have beyond just their academics. The schools are looking for well-rounded students who can contribute to their campus. So have the students been involved in leadership? Have the students been involved in certain clubs at school, such as Red Cross? Have the students been participating in other outside community organizations or nonprofits that can really boost their applications in those ways? Has the student taken any sports? Have they done volunteer work, right? A lot of those things really do carry a lot of weight when the student is applying for college. As we mentioned earlier, grades and courses are only two things that colleges look at when looking at the entire college application. A student's personal statement also carries a lot of weight. How has the student been able to overcome certain challenges in their high school career? How has the student been able to contribute to their community? These are all things that really do contribute to a very successful college application. Talking about being a supportive parent, we sometimes don't maybe have the exact tools that we need to be able to provide the right support that maybe our students need, right? Every student is different. And so as a parent, we really want you to be that support that our student really goes and seeks out when they need it, right? So then instead of setting very high expectations for our students to complete a certain amount of AP courses, I think having a discussion around what our child is capable of doing and how much work they can handle, right? Knowing the limits that they can manage that stress load is very important. These are simply AP recommendations. By no means are we saying that this is how it should be. These are just simply recommendations. So for sophomores, we recommend taking no more than one AP course. For juniors and seniors, we recommend taking no more than two. The reason being that is that we want you to include your child in that discussion of what AP courses they want to take, how many, but also being mindful, as we mentioned, these are college level courses. They are extremely difficult. They will challenge not only the academic abilities of our students, but it will challenge their mental health. It will challenge their physical health. If our students aren't taking care of the mental health aspect of things, they aren't going to be physically feeling well, they aren't going to be able to perform their best. So we make these recommendations based off of that. Focus on colleges that are a good fit for your child rather than a commonly known college. So talk about it generally, ask them what their interests are. Typically we hear a lot of STEM field related sort of career paths, but what other sort of hobbies, interests, activities do our students really like? Because we want to make sure that those activities and such can be also offered at each campus that they're looking into. How does stress impact a student's mental and emotional well-being? A lot of the time, I think we don't talk about this enough. A lot of the time, our students just kind of push through and hoping that, you know what, break is in a few weeks, I'll have time to relax. But a lot of the times, our students are continuously still working through their break. So they don't really get a time to disconnect from that work. Ongoing stress can lead to headaches. It can lead to frequent colds and illnesses and constantly being out sick. Our student is not able to perform and get their work done when they're out sick. And to expect them to continue to turn in work, it's not sustainable in the long run. It can lead to digestive problems. It can lead to memory problems, making poor choices or having poor judgment. A lot of the time, yes, it can lead to substance use, right? Like our students sometimes don't understand and don't have that threshold and ability to manage such high level stress. So sometimes drinking or smoking are one of the things that do occur. It can lead to sleeplessness. Our students are staying up really late and really not having they're not taking care of their sleeping patterns how they should be. They're not getting enough sleep, adequate sleep. A lot of the times, their ability to navigate their emotions can get really impacted too. So our students can become more angry. They can develop anxiety and irritability. And our students can also develop depression, maybe when they're not seeing the results that they're putting, with the work that they're putting into those courses. And so the exposure to the ongoing stress can cause to depression, to anxiety disorders. And we wanna make sure that we are taking care of our students as best as we can. Let's learn a little bit about the signs of both depression and anxiety. Depression can look not just in very simple terms, in terms of just like my student feels sad. It can come in many different sort of things. And the symptoms that we have here on our screen are irritability, ongoing sadness that persists for a very long time, almost every day, fatigue and exhaustion, right? Our student maybe isn't physically tired, but mentally doesn't have the energy or capability to move forward. It can lead to sleep disturbances or insomnia. Our students aren't able to get adequate sleep throughout the night because they're constantly staying up really late or waking up very early. A lot of the students are probably falling asleep in class, right? Which is causing a disturbance in their academics. We want to make sure that we can be recognizing that sign. Another symptom of depression can be significant weight gain or weight loss. Our students potentially are either restricting food or they are finding comfort in food. And so that is another sign that we need to be very aware of. Loss of interest and motivation in school and activities. If our students are usually typically into sports or maybe taking breaks and engaging and watching movies or anime or drawing, if they're starting to kind of isolate and pull back from those activities, that's a sign that maybe potentially depression could be present currently within our students. Feelings of hopelessness and thoughts of suicide. These are all very real conversations that I really want us to be in tune with because a lot of our students typically don't have the tools or resources available to them or readily available to them that they know of that they can use. And so a lot of the times they do feel hopeless when they aren't able to navigate these emotions or these stressors. Thoughts of suicide do sort of come into play, right? And so supporting our students and learning those signs, having those conversations, if they're not feeling well, it's very important to incorporate those throughout our days. Anxiety, constant feelings of nervousness, elevated heart rate, difficulty breathing, right? These can be panic attacks, anxiety attacks. It makes it very difficult for our student to be able to function and focus on their schoolwork. Shaking and trembling, dizziness or lightheadedness, nausea, racing thoughts that they're not able to focus while they're in class, maybe extreme fear, numbness or tingling. And all of these symptoms can be present. And at times our students can do a good job of hiding these things and they'll push through and they'll say, I'm doing okay. Until they reach their breaking point. And we don't want that to be the case. We want to be able to support them. And we'll talk about different ways in a few slides about how we can do that. So managing stress about grades. This is something that typically comes up a lot here at Evergreen as well is understanding the stress behind grades. And it's a very constant conversations that our students are having. we need to convey the message to our students and our children that trying their best and knowing that they did everything that they could is meaningful. It is very meaningful work, and the effort that they're putting into that really does matter. Some classes here on campus, but especially our AP classes, are very challenging. Even though the students are putting a lot of time and effort and hours into studying and trying to succeed in those tests, it doesn't necessarily guarantee them an A. But at the same time, just because our students aren't earning an A doesn't mean that they're not putting in that effort. We want to make sure that we are not having conversations where we're dismissing and invalidating the work and the effort that our students are putting in, because these are tough courses, and we need to make sure that we're using more progressive and positive language and supporting them with that. AP classes are meant to challenge our students. So the grade that they receive isn't indicative of the growth that they have attained through that course, through the life skills that they've been able to gain through that, such as perseverance, tenacity, and that high level learning. But we need to make sure that we're fostering those conversations around how to manage stress and when is it okay to take breaks, step away from the schoolwork for a moment. So parents, what can you do? Create a space to allow your students to express how they are feeling, right? Allow them to openly speak about their struggles, their challenges. Allow them to normalize the fact that, yes, I am stressed and I need some support right now. A lot of the times, maybe the support is taken as, let me help you with the math, let me help you with the science. But I think we also need to take into consideration, let me help you with your mental health. How are you feeling today, right? Recognizing that our child needs balancing in their life. Turning the brain off actually allows them the capacity to learn more. Taking snack breaks, taking a mental health break, taking social breaks and hanging out with their friends. The social worker will sometimes go out of his office and go for a walk around campus to get some fresh air. Me needing to take a break, I'm modeling that for our students, because needing to know when it's time to kind of step back a little bit is very important too. Having an honest conversation with your child about the workload and what they're able to handle, right? The expectations of what this work will look like, and also the potential stress that is going to be possibly coming on. We want to make sure that we are having those conversations, not just at the beginning of the year as we're talking about scheduling, but having them throughout the course of the year. Hey, temperature check, how are we doing? How are we doing with these classes? How are we feeling? Are we feeling okay? Knowing the warning signs of prolonged stress, depression, anxiety, that was on the previous slide. We talked about those various symptoms, right? Knowing those signs. Develop a game plan to, in a sense, be able to recognize those signs of stress, depression, anxiety, and also to encourage our students and our children to take those breaks, to engage in coping skills in order for them to be able to navigate those sort of emotions and conversations. And also parents, modeling healthy practices. I'm sure that coming home from work, we don't want to continue to have to do work. Let's take a break. Maybe let's cook together with all children. Let's maybe watch a movie together, right? Modeling those healthy practices is what is really going to set our students up for success so they can continue to be doing well in their courses. I want to pause a little bit on this slide. Parents, students who are on, if you want to take a screenshot of it, if you're able to, awesome. These are just some flyers that I want to put up, and it's some healthy sort of tips, specifically for parents too, just so how you can sort of build those habits and how to support your student with their mental health. A lot of it is simply just holding space for your child, asking a simple question in terms of like, do you want me to hold space and you just want to vent? Or do you need some solutions and advice right now? Letting our students sort of guide in terms of what they need at this moment. Support for everybody comes in different ways. Not everyone is ready to receive the solutions or the advice or that pep talk to keep going. Sometimes we need to approach it at a very different angle and maybe do a little temperature check, as I mentioned earlier. How are we feeling? Right? Do we need to maybe step away? And using the words we, right, together, you walking with your child and taking a walk outdoors, you supporting your child and letting them know that we need to step away from the homework right now and sort of go and maybe do something a little more relaxing, right? Playing with the dog, cooking together, something like that. I wanted to provide these flyers to you just because sometimes we don't know maybe these certain ideas or something, maybe simple techniques that we can do. And so this is for you. If you want copies of it, I can obviously always send it out to you via email, and we can make them accessible on our webpages as well. But I just wanted to kind of pause on this a little bit so you could maybe read through a few of them and maybe take some pointers as well. So the take-home message, know your child. Resiliency varies greater from child to child, greatly from child to child. Not every single child has the same level of threshold to navigate stress in certain ways. they're still developing, they're still growing. Their brain isn't fully developed until, you know, their mid-20s. And so the stress of taking on 4 or 5 AP classes is tremendous. We need to know, what is our child capable of handling? Be mindful of comparing your child to siblings or to other peers. Our peers, our students already compare each other while they're here at school. And so we don't want to continue that message when we get home. Understanding their abilities, understanding their limits is very important. It helps to know your child's capacity for stress and to also adjust your expectations to align to their abilities. Encourage your children to pace themselves, set realistic expectations, set those realistic goals of when to maybe eat, right? When to go to sleep, setting those healthy boundaries, a consistent schedule, but also like love and support your entire child. Focus on the wellness, not just their academic performance, but focus on their mental wellness, their physical wellness, because they're not going to be able to function well in any of those areas of functioning, their social, their academic, if they're not doing well physically or mentally. So mental health and wellness here at EVHS. The Mental Health and Wellness Center is brand new to the campus this year. Thank you to our admin team and to everyone who's been so supportive of just promoting it and submitting, you know, any sort of gifts to the Wellness Center. We really do appreciate it. We're open Monday through Friday during school hours. During break and lunch, we're open. Maybe a question you might have is, who is the Wellness Center staffed by? It's staffed by me, Mr. Hymus. It's staffed by Ms. Graves. It's staffed by our interns who are also master's level interns. It's staffed by community organizations who work with a lot of our youth as well. A question that you might have as well is, what is offered at the Wellness Center? We do one-on-one wellness check-ins. We provide art materials for our students to engage in therapeutic art. We offer mental health workbooks to navigate anxiety or depression. We offer a meditation space here in the event that our student needs a very quiet space to decompress. We offer mental health groups such as anxiety management, life skills, art therapy, mindfulness communication, grief groups. It's a safe space for all of our students, all of our families. We welcome you to come and check out our space. We really want you to be a part of that community. It's also available to all of our staff. And so it's a place where you can come and decompress, regulate your emotions to be able to go back and then function back in the classroom or to continue to do what you need to do. And lastly, this is the support that we offer here at EVHS in terms of our mental health and wellness. On the screen, you'll see that we have a picture of me and Ms. Graves. So you can see our familiar faces and friendly faces. Attached is our emails, our direct phone numbers to our offices. Ms. Graves is in charge of, you know, students that fall under her alpha with last names N through Z. I support our students, which are A through M, but we support one another in that. And if you are looking for where we're located right next to attendance office. And so once again, thank you so much for the time that you've allowed us here to present to you about mental health and wellness. Thank you to our counseling team and Ms. Edwards for setting this up. It's been a really great presentation so far. So thank you everyone for joining.
Thank you so much, Mr. Jimenez. We sure appreciate it. And it's so wonderful just be a team effort in supporting our students and all that they are as students and as humans. So thank you for your teamwork with that. So this is the portion of our evening where you are going to have a chance to ask questions. So thank you for your patience. Our ask is that you put your questions in the Q&A. Counselors will be, and our social worker will be answering those live audio or maybe putting those. So we'll spend about 15 minutes. So we're going to get started. We'll give you until 7:15. So Ms. Jacob is going to be our first teacher that's going to present. So now we're going to move into our teacher presentations. So we'll get started with our teacher presentations at 7:15. If you've had any questions that have come up from this first portion of our presentation, please put those in the Q&A and counselors will be answering those via audio and also in the Q&A. So thank you again for joining us. Any questions that have come up so far, put those in the Q&A. We'll cut started back again at 7:15.
So answer a question that's on here is, when will we receive our AP form? Tomorrow morning, I will email, we will have a list of your emails, and I will email all of you the copy of the AP form. And Mr. Jimenez, are you still there?
Yes, I am.
I would say if you email me a copy of that flyer, mm-hmm. I think that would be a good idea to include that when I send the AP forms.
The tips about parenting, yes. How the parents can support their mental health of their students?
Yes.
Yeah, definitely.
Perfect. And then so you all get a copy of that as well tomorrow once I'm at work. So the average size of an AP class, it's the same as a regular class. And in our district, different courses have different numbers, typically between 30 and 32 or 29 and 32 per class. And again, the way they're allotted is seniors have, you know, get priority, then juniors, then sophomores, typically is the way that they are assigned. Can a junior take 5 APs? Ms. Kang, you want to answer that live? Or were you just saying? Okay. So normally we would recommend 3 APs in junior year at the most. Again, although this is my first year at Evergreen, I've been a counselor for 20 years. I've been in education for 33 years. And I've seen the negative side of AP and the pressure and some things that it just does to students. So I would be very, very, very careful about having that many APs as a junior. Is there a tie break when 2 juniors select the same set of classes? To be honest, the way that it works is the computer schedules students. I mean, if we had to do it by hand, I don't know what we would do. So the computer is the one that schedules the students. It tries to do it in a way that as many students get the classes that they want. And so, you know, it's not like we go in and say, oh, we're going to give it to this kid, but not that kid. That's not the way it works. It's all based on the computer putting kids in. So can you take chemistry and AP environmental science in your senior year? No, it's one science class. Again, as Dr. Soloff mentioned, because of limitations of space, it is one science class per year. Can a student take AP chemistry outside of? If you took a chemistry class, and not sure how we look at this, but if you took chemistry at a community college, that's like an AP class, but it's not going to have an AP designation because, again, AP is a college level class taken at the high school. However, if you do take a class during summer, for example, you would need to take another science class with us the following year. So if you did take the class with your counselor's permission, the following year, you would need to take another science class.
But if you choose to take, for example, chemistry at the community college, that's equivalent to taking an AP chemistry class. So there's no point in coming back and redoing the same class. Correct. So the answer, there's the Mr. Roberts answer, which is if you do summer work, you need to take a different science. But there's the chemistry specific answer. Is no, you wouldn't come back and take the same class because even though one's AP and one's college, they're pretty much designated the same course and you wouldn't take both of them in that situation.
Right. And that's why I was saying it's a college level class. AP is just a college level class. So either way, you would still get the extra point by taking it at the community college. But again, you wouldn't come back and take it again with us unless you failed the class. And that's the other thing. For students who are taking college classes at the college, that becomes part of your permanent college record. So to be clear, when you take a class at the community college, when you apply to a four-year university, you will need to include the transcript from the community colleges, and that will become, that grade will become part of your college transcript. And they don't care that you took it in high school and that maybe you didn't do as well as you wished. It is part of your college transcript. So just so you are aware of that. Let's see.
There was a question about AP Human Geography, and if a student chooses to take it in ninth grade, what do they do in 10th grade? I would recommend they take World History or AP World History, because even though Human Geo satisfies the college requirement, there's a ton of information that they wouldn't be learning if they don't have a World History course. So it's not going to be required, but 100% our recommendation would be that they choose to take regular World History or AP World History sophomore year.
Another question is, how many hours out of class should you expect with an AP or non-AP class? I think when the teachers get there, because I think it might vary per class, hopefully when we get to the teachers, they can talk about the difference between regular English and English Lang or English Lit in science. So I'm hoping that the teachers will cover that. Again, for prioritizing APs, seniors are given top priority, then juniors, then sophomores. So the question was, and now it's moved, is everyone considered equally for AP classes? And again, priority is given, especially to the more popular classes, priority is given to seniors and then juniors. Okay, what is the algorithm in deciding who is allowed to take the AP classes? So again, as long as the request is in, when we push the magic button, so what we'll do is everybody who asked for it originally, okay, if somebody asked for it, as Dr. Soloff mentioned, in May, they come in and say, I want to take this class. We can look at how many people signed up and say, it's full. Beyond that point, it is the computer that makes the decision, not us. So the computer goes in and again, looks at the optimum way of placing students for getting the most students into their classes. And again, we do prioritize by grade level, but other than that, the computer is the one that makes the assignment. Will the chat be archived and shared? I don't know if we can do that. Do you know, does
anybody- We'll do our best. Mr. Roberts, we'll do our best. We haven't done that in the past, so.
Okay, perfect.
We'll do our best.
Let me mark that as answer live.
There's quite a few questions about, can students take seven periods? We did talk about this extensively through the PowerPoint. So it's way too much to type to answer the questions. It is in the PowerPoint. We've already talked about it tonight per grade level, because there's different answers per grade levels. So at this point, I'm just going to recommend you go back to the PowerPoint and check out the slides and rewatch what we talked about, because it's really too much information just to type over and over and over again in the Q&A. So we're going to hold off on answering any of the more of those questions, because it's very specific and it's a lot of information.
Right. And then I lost it, but somebody asked if they've already, as a junior, finished Calc BC, what math class you can do stats, you can do AP stats. If you would like to continue on to the next level of calculus, because we don't offer the next one, you could continue by taking a class at the community college. Again, just meet with your counselor about that. So that's not an issue. If you've taken all of the classes that we offer, or went as high as we offer, then you know, will assist you in allowing you to move on to the other levels.
As far as the seems to be some confusion, quite a bit of confusion over chemistry and what happens if a student takes chemistry in spring versus summer. Remember, the student has to be currently enrolled in chem in or if they want to take AP Chem next year. Or if not, if they choose to, let's say your student is a freshman or a sophomore and they take chemistry this summer, they can always take AP Chemistry senior year. We're just making, we're choosing classes based on what the student is currently enrolled in and that they'll be finished with by the end of May.
And just to add, we are very fortunate to have our science department chair and our science teacher who will include that as part of their science presentation. So a lot of these questions that are coming up about science will be addressed in a little bit here this evening. So thank you for your patience while we get those questions answered here. We're gonna have about 2 more minutes of questions and then we'll get moving on with the rest of our presentation.
Yeah, so one of the questions is, can you take AP Psychology with physics? Psychology is a social science class, not a science class. So yes, that does not count as 2 sciences. So great question. Again, to be clear, if you took AP Bio and you earned an A, you would have 2 A's worked into your GPA. Only one of the grade, oh, you'd still only get 1 extra point for taking the AP. So to be clear, yes, both would be calculated into your GPA. One would count as 4 points for the A and the other one would give you 5 points for the extra point. So when you're taking AP Bio or AP Chem, you still only get the 1 extra bump, 1 extra point bump in your GPA per semester. For 11th and 12th graders, AP Human Geo is considered an elective. You do not get world history credit for it if you take an 11th or 12th grade, but you do get elective credit for it. Okay. Is computer science pathway program considered an elective? Yes. If admitted in freshman year, it's elective credit for 9 through 12th. However, computer science principles, doctors, we just talked about this yesterday. I believe they is one of them counted?
Principles of Science, CSA, right. Math.
Okay, and they are in the C and D, I mean the A and D category, or A and C category?
C and...
A. No.
No, C and D.
Oh, I was right. Sorry. I don't, you know, after 33 years, you think I've had these figured out. So, yes.
Mr. Roberts, if okay with you, we're going to pause on the Q&A.
Yep, we're good to go.
Perfect.
Great. So we're going to move on. This is the portion of our evening where we have many of our teachers. We have a fantastic faculty here at EVHS and some fantastic AP teachers that are going to speak specifically to their courses, going to answer a lot of the questions that are coming up. So we're going to ask that we pause on the Q&A again so that you can make sure that you're paying attention to the presentation. And many of the questions that you might have will be answered. So thank you for pausing on that. And we're going to start off with our AP Studio Art program. And I'm hopeful Ms. Jacob is here to talk about AP Studio Art.
Yes, good evening. I hope everybody can hear me okay. I just want to welcome all of you tonight. I'm so excited to offer AP Art to EV students. This will be our second year, and I'm very excited to offer all 3 different mediums. So the biggest thing that you need to come away with is I need to meet with students who would like to take an AP Studio course to determine exactly what class they will be in. There are 3 different studio courses, AP 2D, AP 3D, and AP Drawing. So there's different mediums can work in different studio courses. So I would like to meet with your student to figure out exactly what AP class they will be put in. They are required to create 2 separate portfolios. One is a sustained investigation that they create through the whole semester, each for fall and for spring. and that is what I help them work on. They do need to have some previous art making experience. I do recommend at least one beginning or intermediate art course in high school before they take AP, because it just gives them a better opportunity to figure out exactly what mediums they really prefer to work in. I also recommend AP for students who would like to go to college and pursue some type of art degree. It gives them an opportunity to build their portfolio to submit to college courses either their junior year or their senior year. I have some information set up in the AP info so that you guys can go to my website and reach out to me. It has all kinds of links to the AP Central, where you can go and explore all the different mediums that your student may be involved with. This class will take a lot of time. I would say a minimum of 10 to 15 hours a week. They get about 7 hours during the week now that we have our block schedule, which is just great for art, but they will have to put in some extra time outside of class. Most of the materials I will be able to offer for them, but there are some specific mediums like ceramics and mostly 3D that we'll have to discuss. I might have to order some materials for them over the summer. So I would like all of them to reach out to me during our homeroom to set up an appointment with me so I can go over their portfolio and see a little bit of their work and figure out exactly what the best fit is for them. So again, go to my website. It has all kinds of links to AP Central. You can check out all the art that all my students are making currently this year and reach out to me, email me if you have any questions. And then again, yes, have your student or your child set up a meeting with me so I can talk one-on-one with them and figure out the best fit for them.
Thanks so much, Ms. Jacob. Appreciate you being here. And so happy to be able to offer AP art.
Yes, I'm so excited. So please reach out if you have any more questions.
Wonderful.
Have a great evening.
So now I'm hoping Mr. Johnson is here. We're going to move on to mathematics.
Yep.
Coach Johnson, welcome.
Hi, everybody. I'm Dan Johnson. I'm the math department chair. I'm also one of the teachers of AP statistics. We offer five different AP math classes. I'm going to talk about Calc A, B, and BC and stats. And then Miss Meow will talk about our computer science classes since she's part of the Computer Science Academy. And so what I'm going to try to do is sort of go through a lot of the questions that we hear students asking, what should I take, statistics or calculus? And the reality is that they both look good on your college applications, but if you are applying to be an engineer, if you're applying to be computer science, math, then calculus will look better. The colleges will look for that more than they would look for stats. And calculus is what we call the natural progression. If you've gone from math one to math two to math three to math analysis, calculus just follows that. The items that you will learn in calculus AB are based upon those previous courses, especially in the math three and the math analysis classes, whereas AP statistics really kind of stands alone. There's not really prerequisite math in a sense of topics that you've had to learn in order to do AP statistics. So our recommendation is if you've been doing well in math, continue it along that way and take AP calculus AB rather than wait a whole year and then take AB the following year when you maybe have forgotten some of those things that you learned in math analysis. Differences between stats and calculus. Again, stats is that more of variable manipulation, graphing, equations, the kind of thing that you have been seeing in math three and in math analysis. Statistics is much more logic, much more writing about things. In statistics, the calculator does most of the math, and then we end up talking about what do you do with those numbers. And this one statement that's up there, it makes it difficult for some students that every statistics problem is a word problem. There is no just sort of X's and Y's manipulating variables. So a student to do well in stats is going to have to be able to read and get the pertinent information through that, what they read. Favorite question of the students, which one is harder? it really depends on how you define hard. It is harder to get an A in AP stats than it is in calculus, and it's also harder to get an F. And the reason that is the nature of the course. In AP statistics, every chapter, especially in the first semester, every chapter is a brand new topic. In fact, the teachers of AP statistics start on chapter 4. So I'll give you an idea how sort of different things are. We go from 4 to 5 to 1 to 7. And it's hard to get an A in a class like that because you have to be able to excel in all of these different topics. And then when you get around to the final, you have to be able to remember all of these different topics. Whereas calculus is much more like the regular math classes. You continue to build upon what you've done. If you know what you're doing in December in calculus, it was because you knew what you were doing in November. It was because you knew what you were doing in October. Whereas stats, you could fail a chapter and then the next chapter get an A. So it's really hard to fail stats. But it's also really hard to get an A. Which one has more homework? Calculus does a little bit, but I know that question came up in the question and answer. How much homework do all these classes have? My honest opinion on this is don't ask the teachers how much homework the kids have. Ask the kids themselves. If you have friends or siblings in AP calculus, ask them how much homework it is, because they're going to give you a much more realistic picture than what we think is going on. AP calculus has the highest passing rate in the school in terms of, who passes the AP exam. The reality is that our AP calculus teachers work the students really hard, but then they end up having a really high passing rate. In stats, we also have a pretty high passing rate, but not quite as high as calculus. If you are a student currently in calculus AB, so you now have a couple of choices. You have a choice of moving on to stats or to take calculus BC. And our recommendation is really the same sort of thing as whether you move on to stats or calculus AB. If you did well in AB, take BC. It naturally follows. Don't wait a year and forget everything. So if you've been doing well in AB, take BC. If you've been really struggling in AB, then you might want to think about taking stats. So this is just a quick summary of sort of what class you might want to take. I want to let you know also that the math department has put out a much larger document that will be shared with all of the students and as many of the parents as we can through, the idea of Canvas. But if you're a parent, at some point in time in the next week or so, you might want to ask your student to see a copy of the what class should I take next year? Because we really try to break down, based upon what class you're in this year, what class you should take next year. So super quick, if you're in BC this year, you've gone as high as you can in terms of that. So if you haven't taken stats yet, take stats. If you're in AB, you have the choice between taking BC or stats. And our recommendation would be go BC if you've been doing well. If you're in math analysis this year, and by the way, parents, math analysis is what some schools would call pre-calculus trig. If you're in math analysis and you're doing well, we would recommend again that you take calculus AB because you've been doing well. And by doing well in math, we talk about a grade of an A or a B. If you got a C, then you might want to think about taking stats. And then I did see this question come up. What class can I take if I'm in math 3 this year? The recommendation would be that you take math analysis. That's the course that follows. The College Board says that you can take AP stats after math 3. But let me tell you, I've been teaching AP stats for close to 20 years. And almost every single student that comes into AP stats after math 3 does very poorly. So you should really, really think twice about if you want to go into an AP math class. Remember, AP is a college level course. And if you're the highest level you've reached is math 3, you really should probably take math analysis rather than AP stats. That is my favorite topic of all time, summer school. And I saw this come up a billion times. And it really, here's the quick thing. We really, really, really discourage students from advancing in summer school through a math class. Summer school is 5 weeks long. It is so easy to get through summer school by just remembering stuff basically for the next day or, a maximum of a couple of weeks. And the problem is that you get through summer school and you think you know everything, but it's really all just been short-term memory. And we are seeing this much, much, much more prevalent. And especially after couple of years of distance learning. that students who try to advance in summer school end up doing poorly in their future math careers. Granted, it's not everybody. And I know you as a parent say, well, that won't be my kid. But I'm just telling you that we see it all of the time. Students that do, you know, they take it maybe at one of these programs that will charge you a couple $1,000s in the summer. And my quick thought to you on the schools that charge you $2,000, they're not in business to make your student learn math. They're in business to make money. And they're going to teach math along the way. But do you look at the future of what happens past that? I have a 20-minute video of this that's going to be linked to on that other thing that the math people put out, where we just look at kid after kid that this happened to. So, and if you're a student and mom and dad is telling you, you have to do something this summer, so take a math course, I think you really should have a serious conversation with mom or dad about if that's really the right thing to do. And mom or dad, the fastest way to get a no from one of these competitive schools, if you want to apply for, you know, be an engineering major or what have you, the fastest way to get your no is to have a D or a F show up on the transcript in calculus. And we see that too many things where, you know, parents are thinking they're doing the right thing and they are doing exactly the wrong thing. So get off my soapbox here for a while, but seriously, really think about that whole idea of summer school. That is my email. For the students, I'm in room B110. You can always come by and ask me any questions about things. Like I said, I'm one of the AP stats teachers. If you have questions about calculus, I can direct you to the teachers next door who teach calculus or what have you. But you also might want to talk to your fellow classmates in terms of what class they're in and see what they think about the classes. And I'm going to let Miss Meow handle the computer science program that we have here at Evergreen.
Hi, good evening, everybody. To talk about computer science, we have to talk about, can I go next slide? We have to talk about, next slide, please. We have to talk about Computer Science Academy. All right, next slide, please. Yeah. All right, so freshman year, students take exploring computer science. And the sophomore year, students take a database, which is optional. And AP courses comes in as junior and senior. So AP CSP and Computer Science A. Oh, okay. All right. Students will have to follow those courses sequence. They cannot jump. Okay. And we do not expect students to drop out of a pathway. Okay, now what's the difference between CSP and CSA? All right. For CSP, it's designed for non-CS majors. Okay, it's basics for data, problem solving, internet, cybersecurity, and programming. Okay, and there's no specific language required for CSP, and AP exam consists of two parts. Okay, MCQ, multiple choices questions. This year will be given as a digital exam, and then we have a performance task, which is done actually in class. For computer science A, it's actually object-oriented programming with a problem solving, and they use Java. And for students that are considering a STEM field in the future, and AP exam consists two parts, frequent response and multiple choice, they are written. All right. For ECS and CSP, for both two courses, and if you got B or better, then you can get college credit showing up on your high school transcript through Mission College. Okay, and a CSA also, okay, same thing. Okay. It's equivalent to CISA 43 through Mission College. All right, I think that's about it. If you have any further questions, please contact Mrs. Benninger. That's her email and room B138. And that's the website about our Computer Science Academy. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Ms. Miao. I sure appreciate it. We are very lucky to be able to offer computer science classes at EVHS. Now I'm going to pass it off to social science. Mr. DiVincenzi is here. He is our social science department chair, and he's going to speak a little bit about our social science APs.
Hello. For some reason, my video is not coming in. Is it now? Okay. That's not good. Let's try that again. All right. Well, I'm going to start talking and see if I can figure this out. My name is Anthony DiVincenzi, and I'm the Social Studies Department Chair, and I would like to talk to you about the Social Studies classes. We have a lot of them, and for the most part, the Social Studies classes that we offer are contingent on what grade you are. So if you are going to be a sophomore, that is World History. If you are going to be a junior, that is going to be AP US History. And if you are going to be a senior, that is Advanced Placement, Government, and Economics, or Macroeconomics. We do have AP Psychology, which is a junior or senior course. And we have AP Human Geography, which is all levels. My best advice to you as a potential student taking the class or as a parent is going to be that
hold on just a second. I think I got the video figured out. There we go. All right. So is going to be to talk to students that are currently taking the class if you can. They will give you the best understanding of the level of challenge of the class, whether it's hard or not. I would advise that if you are going to ask students that are taking the class, ask how they're doing in the class. Because if they say, I hate the class, I hate the teacher, it's terrible, it's the worst thing ever, and they have a really low grade with lots of absences, that might be the reason for that. But ask students, they'll tell you what the workload is, how much time they put into it, how generally speaking, how they're doing, and so on and so forth. So I would ask students. We have, and I believe it is at the main page for the parents for AP Night, links to videos that each and every one of our AP teachers have made where they talk about the course and what their expectations are. And I would highly encourage you to look at those if you're contemplating a course, to think about whether or not it's worth it, because you're going to be hearing a presentation, a Zoom presentation, or it's a YouTube or whatever the format is, from teachers that are actually teaching the courses, and they can tell you that. As far as skills go, heavy reading skills are required for all the courses. Lots of reading. Even in econ, there's just no escaping that there's going to be a lot of reading, much more so than the on level. And for students that load themselves up with lots of AP courses, what they'll find is they'll have homework for their classes, but something's got to give. And what usually gives is the social studies reading, because they think to themselves, I'm not turning in the reading, it's not for a grade, so I don't have to do it. And that's when students fall very far behind or don't grasp the concept. So expect half an hour to an hour's worth of reading. The other thing is that all the AP courses, except AP Macroeconomics, have a essay component to them. Every AP test has an essay component, which means that the classes are gonna consist of essay writing and the development of essay writing skills. So again, that can be time consuming, challenging, take that in consideration. Like I said, my best advice to everyone is to watch the videos that have been made by the teachers, talk to students that are taking the course, and after this particular presentation, when we get through the end of this presentation, Ms. Edwards will direct you to a Zoom link, and I will be sitting in a Zoom room, and you're more than welcome to hop in and ask me any questions that you might have about the courses. And there it is, look at that. So yeah, that's about all I have though. So thank you guys for attending.
Thank you, Mr. DiVincenzi. Sure appreciate it. I'm hoping Mr. Pham is still here. We are able to offer two different English AP courses, and Mr. Pham is going to speak about AP English Literature and AP English Language. Thanks, Mr. Pham.
Hi. Oh, thank you. Hi, everyone. I'm Mr. Pham. I teach AP Lang here. So a couple of things that I want to address first is Evie does a little bit of, it's a little different in the order. At other schools, you would take AP Lang junior year and AP Lit senior year, but we kind of flip that around. The AP English Literature is given to juniors and AP Lang for seniors. And then a lot of students ask me what the biggest difference between the two AP courses. AP Literature is more focused on reading pieces of literature and analyzing through literary analysis. You will do things like work with different types of literary theory or critical lenses, such as a feminist lens or Marxist lens. You will be looking at a piece of literature through different perspectives. AP Literature has a lot of reading because you're dealing with more books, poems, and things like that. AP Lang is much more focused on writing. So if you love to read, if you love to discuss stories, and you love to look at literature through different perspectives, then AP Literature is for you. AP Lang is very different from AP Literature, even though they're both English courses. AP Lang is much more focused on the use of rhetoric, meaning how to be persuasive, how do you analyze words, and how do you debate, how do you argue. But both classes have an intense amount of writing, and a lot of this writing is timed writing. So if you don't really like essays, or if you don't enjoy reading that much, then the AP Englishes are probably not for you. You are required to have quite a bit of writing skills going in, and AP Lang, I can at least speak for AP Lang, is that those writing skills are used constantly, and we move pretty quickly through a lot of different topics. In AP Lang, we also discuss ethics and different social issues while looking at the AP exam writing. So for those two courses. So once again, lots of reading, lots of writing. And unfortunately, the AP exam is time writing. So it's not exactly process writing. And I want to make you understand that the type of writing for the AP exam is very different from other mediums of writing. So if you might really love process writing, you might really love writing creatively. It is not that. It is very academic writing. And because it's in a time format, we are testing your critical thinking skills and how fast you can analyze and write, read and write. Yeah. We do a lot of group work. As far as the AP Lang teachers go, we do something for like an AP We project where students are working to leave some kind of legacy at the school, meaning they might make some kind of change, and they work really hard to push the rhetoric and be persuasive to admin and to get other students involved. One of the things that have been done recently, for example, is students were able to get feminine hygiene products into classrooms, and that was their legacy that they left, or they started a club, or they worked on something called Cougar Annotations that we all use now. It's annotating the Cougar way. So there are a lot of projects that are done collaboratively. We have a ton of discussions. If you love to just discuss about, you know, very big topics, in my AP Lang class, we just talked about gender norms and sexism in the English language. And so really big topics. And there are a lot of assignments and tons of reading for the homework. Okay. Yep. Yeah. Actually, our AP Lit teachers right now are Aaron White, Ms. White, and Nicole DeVincenzi. AP Lang, we have Mr. Griffin, myself, Ms. Marfia Rosa, and Mr. Omweg. But if you have any questions, please shoot us an email. I can add the email to the chat, my email to the chat right now.
Thanks so much, Mr. Pham. So now we are fortunate to offer four different world languages at our school. Three of them allow us to offer an AP course. So we offer AP Chinese language, We offer AP French language, and then we offer AP Spanish language and AP Spanish literature. So to get more information about those world languages, we've got those teachers' contact information are up there. We're fortunate Ms. Quiroga is here, and she's going to speak about our AP Spanish courses. Ms. Quiroga, thanks for coming. Perhaps Ms. Quiroga is not here. So Ms. Quiroga is one of our Spanish teachers. If you have any questions about AP Spanish language or AP Spanish literature, I encourage you to reach out to her. I'm not sure, she had said she was gonna have a Zoom. I'm not sure now that maybe something came up. So I'm not sure if she'll be able to join that, have that, but I would encourage you to reach out to Ms. Quiroga for any questions with AP Spanish language or AP Spanish literature. So with that, we're gonna pass it over to our science classes. I know Ms. Taylor is here, and I believe Mr. Walls is also here. So Ms. Taylor, take it away.
All right, gotta find the right buttons here. It's been a couple of years since we did the Zooms. Can you actually back up one slide? Yep, perfect, thank you. So, hi, welcome to AP Night. My name is Mrs. Taylor. I'm one of the AP biology teachers, and I also teach AP environmental science, and I'm the science department chair. So hopefully I can answer some of the questions that were in the chat we've got set aside. But before we get to that, I just wanted to kind of bring up something that we as AP science teachers have been discussing. So as you decide whether an AP science class is the right fit for you, we, the AP science teachers, would like to help you make the best choice for your high school experience. Before you sign the AP contract, we encourage you to speak with the AP teacher and ask questions about the course. What sort of topics are going to be covered? What sort of expectations there are, things like that. So get this information before you decide, yes, I want to take that course. We want to encourage you to think about the following things as you're making your choices. Why are you taking an AP science class? Are you interested in it because you're excited about the subject? Do you want to explore careers related to that subject? Do you want to experience what science is like at a college level? Do you want to challenge yourself intellectually, and are you willing to work harder than you do in your other classes? If you answer yes to these questions, then definitely take a look at an AP science class. Something to consider, which you've been hearing about throughout this evening, how many AP classes are you planning on taking? And just to remember that a full load in college is 3 to 4 classes. And it's more along the lines of 3 classes if you're taking a science class in college, because that includes a lab class with it. And so AP science classes should be treated the same way. For AP biology and AP chemistry, these are a 2-period class. And so it's equivalent of a year-long science course at college, whereas the other AP science classes are equivalent of a semester-long science course in college. And so it really is almost twice as much work involved in AP biology and AP chemistry. Since these are college-level courses, the amount of work is higher, and students will need to self-study more than you would in a non-AP class. You need to be prepared for this. Yes, you will have help from your AP teachers in terms of office hours and study sessions, but we have to follow a tight timeline that's dictated by the College Board. And unfortunately, we don't have the luxury of slowing down for you to catch up, because we have to get through a certain amount of curriculum before the test in May. This means that you would need to be an advocate for yourself and work with the teacher outside of class for more help. This also means that you might do your absolute best and still get a B or a C in your science class. And that's actually fine. A B in a science class on a college transcript on an AP science class goes a long way. Colleges recognize the difficulty of the AP science classes. We want all of our students to be successful in their science classes, but we also want our students to be healthy in terms of their mental health. And something to think about is that if it's going to cause you severe anxiety to get a B in a science class, then maybe you want to consider whether AP science is correct for you for this year, because you maybe you want to take a different science elective and have a little bit of time to grow and mature in science before you jump into the AP class. But really remember also that a B in AP sciences is nothing to sneeze at. That is a fantastic grade. And we need to respect that and honor that as well. So I do want to get to some of the questions here that people have asked, but really we want our students to come to science because they are passionate about the science, because they're really fascinated by it and they want to learn and they want to have fun and they want to do really cool things and maybe not worry quite so much about what their letter grade is at the semester time, but worry about learning science. And so that's really important for all of the AP science teachers that we have here at Evergreen. Okay, let me go through the slides and then I'll hit some of the questions. So for all AP science classes, 25% of the class needs to be a lab type of activity. And this is dictated by the College Board. Most of the labs are very open-ended. They're experimental labs. Students have to analyze data. They have to make predictions. What do they think is going to happen next? And there's really a lot of critical thinking skills that are required in order to be successful within the labs. And these skills translate to the classes and they translate to just the world in general, being able to look at something, ask questions, try and figure out how to solve those questions, and then come up with a conclusion. Okay, next slide. So, excuse me, AP Biology. So there were several questions that popped up about this one, and I'll try and hit those as well here. So AP Biology, I like to say, is like biology class that you took in freshman year on steroids. We do similar topics to what was covered in freshman biology, but we go into much greater detail, much greater depth with it. And so it's a very intensive class, but it's also a lot of fun with it. We do have three different AP biology teachers this year, and we all work together and basically team teach together with the classes. It is a two-period class. So that means that it would meet for example, first period and second period. So with our block schedules on Monday, I see my first and second period class for first period and second period right after it. Then I also see them on Tuesdays for first, and then Wednesday for second, Thursday for first, Friday for second. So I see my students all 5 days out of the week. And as I mentioned before, both this and AP Chemistry have this schedule because there really is almost twice as much material that is covered. So we do a lot of work in that time, but it also gives us an opportunity for a lot of labs and activities. So recommended prerequisites. This came up in with the chat questions about chemistry. And I believe one of the people asked, apparently kids have taken AP Bio without chemistry last year. Has the policy of prerequisites changed? No. So it's recommendations. Basically, you could come to us and say, I want to take AP Biology my sophomore year, and I understand I have not taken chemistry yet, and I still want to take it. That's your choice. We will strongly recommend against that, though. There have been a few students who do this, and they're very successful, but they've had to work really hard, especially the first couple of units in school. And we jump right into the chemistry stuff, and we're using the chemistry. We're not necessarily teaching it. It's more of a, hey, you learned about this last year, and now you have to use it. And so the students who are successful, for the most part, are the ones who have taken chemistry. And yes, there are those occasional students who are just phenomenal and they can manage it. But for the most part, they really struggle with it. In terms of the homework per night, it really is not 45 minutes per night. But you're going to have some nights where you have a lot and then some nights where you don't have anything at all. And so it's a matter of learning how to budget time. That's a big thing that we really stress is you might be given an assignment and then you have a week to get it done. If you procrastinate and wait until Sunday night, it's going to take you 2 hours. So those are skills we always try and push. Okay. Is AP Science the same class for junior or senior year? Yes, it is. So, for example, my AP Bio classes, I have a mixture of juniors and seniors. So it's the same class. It's not separated by grade level or anything like that. Okay. And we'll just hit the quick questions while I'm on the questions. What science-related electives are offered at EVHS? We have these in the course catalog. But we also we offer the different AP sciences I'm going to mention tonight. And then we also have forensics and human physiology that are offered. And they're in the course catalog. Okay, and then AP Bio and AP Chem, it's a single class. Well, it is a single class. On your transcripts, it goes in as AP Biology and then AP Biology Lab. So you do get two grades for it. It's the same grade, but it does show up twice on your transcript. Same thing for AP Chemistry. And if a student took chemistry over the summer at a community college and then came in to take AP Biology, then that would be their choice. But they would not be able to take chemistry at community college and then AP Chemistry at EV. Because that's technically the same course. So I think that hit all of my questions. Okay, next slide. And I think we're on to chemistry. So Mr. Walls is gonna jump in here for the chemistry one.
Hi, good evening. I'm Mr. Walls, teach AP Chemistry since 2008, 2009. So I've seen quite a few different backgrounds of students. And I just wanted to add a small blurb. When I took chemistry in college, there was a placement test that you had to take. So I'm seeing a lot of questions in the Q&A about what if I take high school equivalent chemistry at such and such junior college or whatever. Just know that when I took it at UC, it was a placement test. If you didn't get a certain score, you weren't allowed to take it. So the school determined that you needed like these prerequisite skills, unit analysis, like drawing a molecule structure, etc. And if you didn't have that background, it was not apt for you to take it. You should take a remedial course. So most of the students this year there's a handful that have not had any prior background. And the first month or so, I go into a lot of what students learned in general chemistry or like the high school equivalent, but it's really fast paced. So if you click on the College Board's curriculum guidelines, it's over 100. I lost count. It's over 100 bullet points, learning objectives that they're supposed to know. So in other words, it's really fast paced. And if they don't know the script, we work on that a lot. I teach general chem and AP chem, and we work on like just writing the script. Like when you write a molecule, the little numbers at the bottom, H2O, that two, there's a lot of implications for that small little two. So it's not good to leapfrog over all of that stuff because you just need to be mindful you're learning a brand new script, like the way your mind thinks, the symbols, the language, there's a whole linguistics that's involved. And it takes a whole year of study to get used to what those small numbers mean, what the proportions mean when you balance a reaction, navigating the periodic table. Why does it have this weird shape? Why does it go up? Why does it go down? There's electron structure, explains all of that stuff. And we go over that in general chem. It takes a whole year. It's really not advised to just leapfrog over that. And the UCs deem it so not wise that they require a test that you have to take. And there's a hard black and white number that you have to give. You don't get a certain number, you cannot take it. It's simple as that. So I just wanted to add a small blurb that it's not wise to advise leapfrogging over regular chemistry. There's a whole linguistics you need to learn. The periodic, the way it's shaped, we spend a lot of time. It takes a month to a month and a half just to navigate the shape. Why does it look like that? Where are the metals? Where are the nonmetals? What are the metals useful for? What kind of new batteries can we try to create in the future, you know, to try to, you know, wean ourselves off of fossil fuels? There's a lot of things to explore, a lot of curiosity that shouldn't be looked over, that just leaped over like that, that could wind up, you know, building interest in the student. And I think that if you build interest in the student, they'll innately want to study the subject, and it won't be so dang hard when you have like quizzes all the time and such, you know, memorize this list of ions. If they're actually interested in the subject, it's not that bad. I've seen it happen. And the student looks, you know, they have a little more, you know, they work better in groups. They're more interested in the subject. And then they bounce their ideas. They can explain something that I explained differently in their group. They can help their team members. And it becomes more a cohesive learning environment too. So it's not, you know, it's really important to develop an interest in the subject. And I think patience and, you know, becoming curious about, like, you know, taking your time. Hey, why does sunscreen, you know, why does the bonding in this sunscreen, some sunscreens are chemical, some are physical. The ones that you put on and it looks all white, I put that on my kids because that one's a physical blocker. The other one that rubs in is a chemical blocker. Well, how does that work? So there's, you know, you have to develop an interest. And then when you start doing word problems and stuff like that, it gets a lot easier. So just don't leapfrog over the initial subject. Don't just gloss over finding how interesting the subject can be. And I think it's a much more healthy way to do it. So I just wanted to add my point of there's no rush in trying to be the best at all the subjects you're taking. Thanks for your time.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Walls. Okay, next slide. We'll get through the rest of the science ones. So AP Environmental Science is also set for juniors and seniors. And this class is, I think it's one of the best classes at school, and then partially because I teach it, and it's something I'm very interested in and passionate about. So one of the big things about AP Environmental Science is that it is a science-based class. It is probably one of the more challenging AP science classes, but it's also a great class for people who want to take an AP, but maybe are not necessarily really into science, but they're into public speaking. Maybe they want to go into law. They want to become a politician, going into a lot of different types of professions. Maybe they want to go into advertising or geographers, business, all sorts of different things. AP in environmental science is actually a really great course to take because this is a subject that is very important worldwide right now, and it's only going to become more and more important. And so I had one student several years ago who sat down and we did the first day of school. Why are you taking this class? And she said, honestly, I'm really not into science. But I wanted to take something. So here I am. Well, she ended up loving the class and has a minor in environmental sciences now. And so I just want to point this out that this is not just a science class. Because of that, it's a challenging class because you are trying to put together a lot of the different sciences. Plus, then we talk about human populations and geography and a little bit with politics and laws and stuff like that. So it's a very complex subject. So pre-recommendations for this, biology and then chemistry or physics. So this would be something if somebody took biology as a freshman, physics as a sophomore, but did not necessarily want to jump into AP physics and didn't want to take chemistry yet, then they could take AP environmental science. And it's a great class for that type of pathway. Definitely a fair amount of self-studying with it. Like we have students do more reading from the textbook, but then that opens us up for discussions in class because the discussions are where the rich learning really comes from with it. Just like any of the others, it also has about 25% of the class is lab-based. So there is that part of the science with it, with the labs. But it's a fantastic class. It is a single period class. And so all of our AP sciences that we're going to talk about from here on out are just single period. So that fits in with schedules a lot better as well. All right, next slide. Okay, physics. I will do my best to help with talking about the physics stuff. I am not a physics person. And so we laugh about that. So AP, we have three AP physics classes available at EV. This is really pretty cool, actually. We're one of the few schools in the area that has all three of the AP physics that are offered. So AP Physics 1 can be taken if you're fairly strong in math, you can do AP Physics 1 without taking general physics first. So if you wanted to go into engineering as a career, you could take biology as a freshman and then jump right into all three of the AP physics classes. And so that would be fine as well. But you do need to have the math skills for it to be successful with it. As Mr. Love says, this is the rockets and circuits of the AP classes. I honestly have no idea what that means other than rockets. And so it is a one period class. And again, 25% of it's doing labs. And he estimates about 30 minutes a night for homework. We have two AP physics teachers, both Mr. Lubbs and Mr. Tam, and they tend to trade off on who's teaching AP Physics 1. All right, next slide. So AP Physics 2, this is also a one period course. And in general, Mr. Lubbs recommends you take AP Physics 2 after you've taken AP Physics 1. Or if you took conceptual physics, you could then jump into AP Physics 2. And it really is different topics. They are not the same course. They are very different topics with it. And so fluid mechanics, thermodynamics, electricity, magnetism, optics, atomic and nuclear physics are all part of AP Physics 2. And I would suggest if you're not sure which AP Physics class you want to take, but you know you want to take one of them, go talk with Mr. Lubbs and he would be able to give you a much better understanding of what is offered and what the content is of the different classes and which one would be the best fit for you. All right, next slide. So AP Physics C, and yes, we did go from 1 to 2 to C, and our non-physics folks really laugh at this. So AP Physics C is a different AP class. This one is calculus based. And so for this AP Physics class, you really need to be either in calculus AB or having already passed calculus AB. And so concurrent enrollment is fine. This is one class that you can go straight from freshman biology into AP Physics C as a sophomore if you want, as long as you have the calculus for it. So you do not need to do either of the other AP classes or conceptual physics before you take this one, as long as you have the math for it. And so if you're in calculus at the same time as this, then they'll teach you the calculus that you need at the time. So it actually helps with your calculus class as well. And so he's got the topics listed here, which again, I know it, none of these are. Kinematics, Newton's laws, I think I remember those from high school. Work, energy, power, systems of particles, linear momentum, circular motion and rotation, oscillation and gravitation. And so a little bit more homework involved for Physics C than you would see with AP Physics 1. But they're all excellent classes. All right, next slide. I think that was us for, oh, that's right. We've got a few, we don't need to spend too much time on these. I know we're running late on time. So is an AP Science hard? No, not necessarily, but you need to be smart about it. And you need to be ready to ask questions, and you need to be ready to make mistakes, learn from those mistakes, and move forward. And so as the physics folks like to say, don't use a hammer on a screw. And so you got to think about it a little bit. If you really like a lot of hands-on stuff, AP Physics is a great class for you because they do a lot of building and then testing things. So it's definitely more hands-on in that sense. We do a lot of labs with the other classes, but they build a lot in AP Physics. All right, next slide. Already mentioned, should I take conceptual physics before AP Physics 1? You don't have to, but you can. Calculus needs to be concurrent with AP Physics C, but not with either 1 or 2. And so you do use the math, but you don't need to have the high level math for AP 1 and 2. How can you be successful? And honestly, this goes for all of the AP classes. You have access to AP Classroom. There are daily videos there. There's tutoring available, asking for help. And it really, truly is a mindset. If you come into class ready to listen and pay attention and ask questions, you're going to be successful. All right, next slide. Okay, so some of the common questions we get. I took physics as a sophomore and I really want to take AP Chemistry junior year. I haven't taken general chem yet. As Mr. Walls already said, we really, really don't recommend you jump into AP Biology or AP Chemistry without the chemistry first. There's so much that you learn in a general chemistry class all year long that you use in these higher level AP classes. You just take the time and take the class and you'll get so much more out of it that way. Can you do it? Yes, but we really don't recommend it. And then I already mentioned I'm not really a science person. Is APES a good choice? APES is an awesome choice for that. I did also make note earlier, you heard that we now have the AP Human Geography class in with social sciences. AP Human Geography actually blends very, very well with AP Environmental Science. And in some schools, they actually teach it together. And so if you would like to do AP Human Geography and AP Environmental the same year, that's actually a really good choice. You're going to see a lot of overlap between the two classes. And so again, AP Environmental is not just a science class. All right, next slide. And so here, the big thing is come talk to us. Mr. Cheadle and myself are with AP Biology. We also have Ms. Fehrenbach in new this year, teaching AP Biology. But if you come to one of us, we'll be able to answer your questions. Mr. Walls, of course, for AP Chemistry. We also have Mr. Maestas, who's new this year for AP Chemistry. Myself and Mr. Ashu Kumar are the AP Environmental Science teachers. And then we have Mr. Lubbs, and we do also have Mr. Tam teaching AP Physics now this year as well. So just come talk to some of us and ask your questions, and we'll help you get into the right class. All right. Thank you. Sorry for taking so long on the sciences.
It's all very important. Ms. Taylor, thank you so much. We are so lucky to have sciences here, but it's important for people to know what they're signing up for. So we appreciate the details and all the information. That concludes our portion of the AP event or our AP night this evening. We are grateful for you joining us. We know it's been a long night. It's been a lot of information, but we think it's important that our families and our students hear, hear what's going on and make sure that they're when they're choosing an AP course, that they're smart in making that selection. So as much as we encourage it, we also you want to make sure it's a healthy choice for you and for your student and for you as a family. So next step, as Mr. Roberts said at the beginning of the presentation, you will be receiving an AP expectations form via an email address. So make sure you're checking your email with what you signed up for here. And you need to fill out that AP form and bring it to, the student needs to bring it with them to their meeting with their counselor. So their one-to-one meeting with the counselor, they'll get a Calendly invite, what they need to set up, and they'll work with their counselor on enrolling in an AP course. Students that don't bring that will have to follow some other steps. So you're going to want to make sure you bring your expectation forms to the one-to-one meeting so that you can sign up for your class. All of this will be posted online. So this presentation and the slides will be posted on our website. So they'll be on the, it'll be on the counseling website under presentation. We also encourage you to go to that website. So we have all the AP information is at tinyurl.com/EVHSAP2023. As many of the teachers spoke about, there's videos, there's lots of information on that website. Our course catalog has all sorts of details. So we're so happy that we have that those resources available for you. So check that out and make sure you're getting any of the information that you may need. Thank you for joining us this evening. Mr. DiVincenzi is going to host a Zoom session for those that might be interested in checking out a Q&A. I'm going to ask him to keep it short and sweet because it's starting to get a little bit late for people. So students need to get some sleep. Teachers need to make sure they're with their families. So he will be opening that up. I'll put that up here on the screen. That does conclude our evening. Thanks so much for joining us, everybody. We hope you have a great night. Stay safe. And we look forward to working with you and getting you ready for next school year. Thanks so much, teachers and counselors and social worker, for your presentation this evening. You're fantastic as always. I can't thank you enough. So thank you for all you do. Thank you, Cougars. Have a great night. And I'm going to put up Mr. DiVincenzi's Zoom link here now. For the rest of you, have a great evening. And please reach out with any questions. Thanks so much. Take care, everybody.